Hello and welcome to NewsClick. Today we're going to be talking about the depositions of the heads of four tech companies. That's Amazon, Facebook, Google and Apple in front of the US House of Representatives Committee on Antitrust. Now these four tech heads were called to answer questions by legislators, both Democratic and Republican. The main focus, there was a variety of questions actually, but the main focus were whether these companies were too big, whether these companies were not allowing competitors to grow and suppressing competition, whether they were having a larger dangerous effect on democracy itself. So to talk more about this, we have with us Prabir Purkayastha. Prabir, thank you for joining us. So to begin with, could you talk about maybe what was the larger sense that came out of these hearings? Because we do know that each of these companies has been questioned, and especially in recent years, for many practices which can be called harmful, which can be called unethical. And these people are, these men are also the richest in the world. So where do we see these hearings going?
Well, it's interesting. These are called the GAFA, Google, Apple, Facebook, Amazon. Right. Now, these, as you said, are the four biggest tech companies in the world, along with Microsoft, which incidentally wasn't here, which is as big a monopolist as the other four. Right. But Microsoft has come under the scanner earlier. It had criticisms of different kinds. So this time, I guess, the other four were the dock. It's an interesting issue because we are again hearing about monopolies in the United States after quite some time. You know, the earlier bunch of anti-monopoly issues that had come up came up really at the end of the 19th century. And that continued for quite some 30, 40 years, breaking up the oil companies. Last big anti-monopoly action was really breaking up the Bell monopoly. And after that, we haven't heard any talk about monopolies in the United States. The sudden rise of the tech monopolies over the last 10, 12 years has really flagged this particular set of actions. Actions at the moment in terms of congressional hearings. The interesting part is the reference repeatedly made to Justice Brandeis, who did talk about the incompatibility of monopolies and democracy, and said you can either have monopoly power or you can have democracy. You can't have both. Now, the United States has believed that the good of, as it was to be called, General Motors in those days, which was the leading monopoly, General Motors was good for United States. Now we can say what is good for GAFA is good for United States was possibly the philosophy for some time. And interestingly enough, it has rubbed the political establishment differently. And this monopoly hearings is part of it, monopoly, which I think a number of people are worried about, which has been a consistent criticism. A part of it is also political posturing coming from Russia hacked our elections to Trump basically hacking the elections with different support of Putin, as well as the fact that a lot of conservative opinion, including even Trump's and Trump's sons, some Twitter actually exercising what would be called censorship on them. Now, this is also the obverse of the other part of it, which is monopoly. And they are saying that you are exercising monopoly power to curb our speech, or you're not giving us a free hearing. So that brings up the issue of hate speech versus what is fair speech. And that's a different ballgame altogether. And I would say that if monopolies emerge, then of course you have an issue. Who does the censorship? Because you cannot accept that there is no bar on quote-unquote free speech to the extent of all kinds of things being said, incendiary violence being roused and so on. So particularly with lynchings we have seen in the country, I think this is a completely untenable position anywhere in the world. But there is a strong opinion in the US that we should be allowed to do anything on as far as speech is concerned, and all of this is free speech. So it really had two very different elements coming together. And that's why the four were on the dock. And if it was monopoly power, then five should have been on the dock. And therefore, the fact that Microsoft wasn't also meant that it was conflated with other issues. Coming to the key issue that you're raising, the issue of monopoly. and the exercise of monopoly power, I think is also clear from what the documents that were apparently presented to the congressional hearing members, as well as what's come in the public domain from in other context research, not necessarily in this, that this monopoly power extracts at least a 30% rent on their platforms. This 30% rent is what Amazon extracts from the people who supply products through Amazon. It has led to bankruptcies down the line, but Amazon has an infinite supply of new players who come hoping that they will not face the same consequence. And therefore, they're not really too bothered about the fact that the bankruptcies of Amazon partners are taking place continuously. So the 30% seems to be the figure that has emerged. And as somebody has said, I pay 20% tax to Uncle Sam, 30% tax to Amazon. Now, interestingly, 30% is also the figure that came out from the hearings, which some people said the Apple apps, those who use the or give their apps to Apple and earn earnings from that, they also pay a flat 30% rate to Apple. So the tax is for both a 30% on whoever supplies to their platform. So this is the monopoly power they assert. Now there are other ways they're asserting powers which I'm not getting into. But it's a classic issue of you're a monopolist to those whom you whom you buy. You're a monopolist to those whom you supply. So this is the double-sided monopoly which an Amazon or Apple, in the case of the app stores that it has, obviously uses. But let's come to the bigger issue for me, that these companies are not just local monopolies. They're not US monopolies. They're really global monopolies. And rest of the globe doesn't seem to have any power to control them. There are also companies which are not officially headquartered for tax reasons in the US. They are in Cayman Islands or some such tax havens. So they pay very little income tax to the US government, though they are US companies for all, you know, whatever the fiction they might maintain, they're really US companies and they have all attended the US congressional hearings. So they haven't said, hey, we're not US companies, why should we come before you? So the issue is that any country which has summoned them, and India has, in fact, if you remember, India had summoned Zuckerberg, who refused to come. And though our telecom minister issued some threats at the time, he seems to also have forgotten about it. Ravi Shankar Prasad said, India, government of India is calling you. But I don't think he later on remembered what he had himself said. So it's the fact that they did appear before the US congressional hearings, these are US companies, that's an admission. So rest of the globe doesn't seem to have any role in this. Now, there are committee hearings or there are various antitrust hearings, which I'm using the US word, but basically various regulatory agencies have taken up the issue, starting from Australia to Europe, about the monopoly power they exercise. So this is a very real issue. How do you prevent this monopoly power in different parts of the world from being exercised? And how do you protect your local market from what essentially are American companies? This, I think, is the second issue that we have to really think about. The third is, how is this monopoly power being exercised? And it's very interesting because when the internet started, it was people were connecting directly to each other. And we thought that the main monopoly power of media, which meant that you had to go for news or for television or for even cinema, you went to a few established players, they had the monopoly. That this monopoly, therefore, allowed them to extract monopoly rent from others. And if we are directly able to talk to each other and we are able to directly convey news to each other, in groups, in smaller, more disparate markets, so to say, not controlled by centralized conglomerates, then we would get a much more democratization of the media and news. What instead happened is this entire set of companies that sprung up, and Google, of course, was the first big one, they centralized this entire internet. So we don't connect to each other directly, we connect to Google. I give a Gmail to you, you do a, you know, you write back on Gmail. We are not connecting to each other as we did originally, but we are connecting to Google. So what has happened is a whole infrastructure of Facebook, Google has been built up by which they control from both sides. They control what you do, what you see, what how you write, to whom you write. All that information, of course, is, as we know, data is also money. But more than that, what has happened is they're in the middle. And what we think is the internet is really Google and Facebook increasingly. In fact, 70% of the internet traffic today is Google and Facebook. So this is the centralization of the net. And this is a centralization which is not a single country. Earlier, media, telecommunications were monopolies, but monopolies in their countries. Now we have got an entirely a global monopoly in which four, five, six companies completely rule the roost. So we have really got centralization and creation of monopolies on a scale that we have never faced before. And it's really last 15, 20 years that we have seen this develop. I think this is the much bigger threat. These are international monopolies controlled at one side by the United States, backed by the United States. If anything happens, in fact, even in India, if the US embassy takes an interest and also intervenes in these issues. And therefore, these are not companies which are without the blessings and the protection of the United States, even if the United States congressional hearings are on these companies as well. So this is the centralization of monopoly power these companies are really asserting. And you can see that the rate of profit, which is really the monopoly rent they're extracting by building these technological methods of monopolization today, means that they have a profit margin far beyond what any other company has. And they are able to leverage this into newer and newer fields, which is the Google example, and which Pramila Jayapal, one of the congressional members of the committee, said that, you know, why is it when you do a Google search, you go to Google sites rather than to other sites? So this is an obvious issue. How do you misuse your position on search engine to directing people to sites and so on? So whatever it says, that this is the reality, that technology has built new monopolies on a scale we haven't seen before. And this is not the oil monopoly, not the telecom monopoly. This is far more pervasive than what we have seen so far. And the solution does not lie in hearings and talks and, you know, tax increases and so on, but being able to break up the monopolies. There is no other answer. Right. Either nationalize or break them. These are the only two ways to go. And if countries like India have to face it, it has to see how to protect its internal market. This is what China has done. People think China, the great firewall of China, is about censorship. No, it is not. It is about building an internet which is free from these companies. And that's why the sixth largest company in the world today is a Chinese one. It's Alibaba. So, in fact, that's how they have become strong, because they have a home market in which they could play. Right. And then you have Tencent, you have a couple of others. So you see that apart from China, there's nobody else who's protected its internal market, maybe partially Russia. And we have decided, as of now, to ban all Chinese companies virtually for playing in the Indian market. But we have opened ourselves completely to the American companies in the belief that that's the alliance we need. But that's, as the Amazon and others now balance sheets clearly show, that this is a completely one-sided alliance. Yeah. You don't really get benefits from it. And what you do is really surrendering your internal market to this company.
And Prabir, as a follow-up question, just to sort of elaborate on the idea of breaking it up itself. So there's been a lot of talk about it, especially over the past decade or so, once the Snowden revelations came out, about the kind of backdoors the US government had on this. Once the Cambridge Analytica issue came out again, there was a huge furor. In fact, even in these hearings, congresspersons did ask about what happens when Google becomes your gateway to the internet. But how does actually breaking these companies up look like, both in terms of the legal frameworks that are required and the final technological framework that may emerge? Because often the argument posed is that These companies are so big, so they're able to, you know, provide this bouquet of services which would not be available to people otherwise.
You know, monopolies have always given these kind of arguments. We have economies of scale, we can do A, we can do B. Not completely untrue. That's why they are monopolies. But the point is that they also stifle a whole bunch of other technological revolutions, right, improvement that can take place, and also crush all dissent. They can crush all other companies which they see as competition. But more importantly, politically, they in fact work to see that the American viewpoint globally is the viewpoint that is presented. So right, as if you go and search, you know, Mandela was arrested because by the South African police, because the apartheid South African police, if you remember, because the American embassy informed on him that they had wanted to meet with him, to talk to him. And they also then informed the South African police, hey, he's in town, you know, right, so you can arrest him. He's probably here. So these are the things that you won't find if you do Google search. You will find a lot. I mean, it's not that it is completely erased out of memory, but you will find it's hidden away under so many other queries that you get. Mandela is this nonviolent apostle of peace. Mandela did go in for armed revolution. So that he supported armed revolution. He was very much a part of it. So all those things are then airbrushed out of history. If you do Google search, you have to go to 10th, 11th, 12th page of Google to see this. Now, this is political power which is being asserted. And of course, it is with partnership with and in collaboration with the United States agencies. It's not happening innocently, though, you know, people would like to believe that it is so. So this is political power. So I think there are two sets of issues here. One is, how do other countries protect their home market against predatory players like Google? Now that's one set of issues that we have to take up. Do we promote our own search engine? Do we also see that Google search engine is not allowed to be used in India, for instance? Should it be so harsh? Do we then, if we are reacting as a country, what do we then do? These are questions we have to really look at. And at the same time, if it is the US which has to look at all this, US has to basically look at the fact how to break up Google. That's the key issue in front of these companies, how to break up their different businesses. For instance, Bell, when it was the telecom company, it wasn't allowed to enter the whole range of business. In fact, it had 32-bit chips before anybody else. They had 32-bit technology at the time, really path-breaking. But they couldn't enter the computer market, for instance. That's why you see a whole range of Bell products, from software to other things, were available free, because they had to give that away if they had a telecom monopoly. Right. In fact, one of the reasons they were willing to give up the telecom monopoly, they thought that they could enter other areas and make money out of it. So those are the kind of things that you have to say. If you want to be a search engine, you just do this and nothing else. All other activities have to be hived off. You can't enter into it. So all those kind of things have to be done. But it's not an easy one, because between media, search engine, media, social networks, the connection has become so intimate that's not going to be so easy either. The other alternative is to break them up as independent companies, like it was done with Bell Labs, that you got different companies doing different business, different areas, in this case, different businesses. Will that succeed? I don't know. But these are some of the issues that will have to be looked at. But the most important one in terms of an approach would be to declare these are public utilities. And if they're public utilities, there are certain rules they have to follow, including a fixed rate of profit, not more than that, 2% profit, 3% profit, that's it. So there are various ways of regulating, but all of it needs a political will. And at the moment, the political will is to bend Facebook and Google to Trump's viewpoint, so to say, don't censor us, don't do this, don't do that, but not raising the key issue. How are you a monopoly? Does monopoly itself affect what you do to others? And how do we break monopoly power? Though it has come up in the congressional hearings, Justice Brandeis, who talked about democracy and monopoly being incompatible, has been quoted enough number of times by the congressional committee. So, you know, there is hope yet. But looking at the larger American politics, this doesn't seem to be immediately in the offing. And it's also interesting that COVID-19 has really increased the monopoly power of the digital monopoly. The digital monopolies have never had it so good as they have had during the COVID-19 epidemic, because you can see their stock rates, which have gone up. You can see the stock market. They have done exceedingly well. And it's not surprising, because online deliveries have increased. People have gone much more on the net. So, you know, Amazon Prime to others are all making money out of it. So you have a whole range of things which have, because of the kind of physical lockdown issues that have come, which have helped them. But at the same time, the political centralization as well as the economic centralization of power of these companies, and I would think that, you know, Microsoft is a very important player in this, has to be looked at. And, you know, finally, Prashant, the key issue is really technology. That, you know, these monopolies have been come by clever, entrepreneurship. They have come because technology, new technological frontiers had opened up, the internet, and somebody had to emerge. And these companies then got a global stage to emerge. And therefore, they have become really global players, because the internet is a global space. And I think that is the key issue, that technologies will always create the opportunities for new monopolies. And unless you are able to break up monopoly power politically, through political action, you cannot break it up by just talking about it. And I think that is the crux of the issue we are facing today. Right. And the fact that different regulators are talking about it, I think there's a worldwide acceptance now that this is not simply an American issue, European issue, Australian or Indian issue. This is a global issue. And we need, at the end of it, something which will allow us to tackle it globally as well as locally.
Thank you, Prabir, so much for talking to us. That's all we have time for today. Keep watching NewsClick.